Hi, I'm Zach Adam from the University of Arizona, and today we're going to talk about geological conditions, change, and chaos with reference to the origins of life. And basically, we're going to talk about what's the source of our understanding of what the Earth looked like around the time that we think life originated on our planet. And there are many ways of looking at the rocks around us today, and we generally think that the rocks that are underneath our feet seem pretty immutable and unchanging. They don't change on a day-to-day basis. They don't change on a year-to-year basis for the most part. And it can be kind of easy to fall into this thought that rocks, once they're around, they stick around. And therefore, any rock from the time of Earth's early past might be very similar to the way it was back then, or might be similar to the rocks that we see today. And what we're going to learn is it's really a little bit more complicated than that. And we have to keep some important caveats in mind when we consider reconstructing what the Earth and the surface environment look like early on in the history of the Earth. So when we talk about Earth's geology, the number one thing that comes to my mind is rocks, right? Geology. But it's really a lot more than that, because the history of the Earth extends almost all the way up into space and all the way down into the core of the planet. And so when we think about the Earth as a large structure, we have to keep in mind that the Earth is really including all of its interaction with the near space environment, and that includes its magnetic field and any interaction that solar flare particles or charged particles are having on the upper atmosphere. It includes the composition, structure, and overturning and transport of a material in the atmosphere itself, going from the surface of the planet up into space. And we come back down to Earth, it includes, yes, rocks. It includes water. It includes all of the dynamic processes going on around us. When we zoom in on those rocks, it includes the minerals that make up those rocks. And when we zoom in on those minerals, it includes the atoms that make up those minerals. And at each stage of organization of our planet, there are different kinds of information that we can extract. And we might look at the chemical composition of the rocks. We might look at the arrangement of the minerals in those rocks, and we might look at just the atomic composition of those minerals. Is it the same as the minerals we see today? Are there other lurking atoms that are between the atoms that make up the minerals that might give us some clue as to what was going on in the atmosphere or in the ocean? So we have to think of all of these different types of information when we think about reconstructing the geologic history of our planet. But it's not that simple. So when we look at the inside of the Earth's structure, generally we're really only talking about sampling the crust. The Earth is thousands of kilometers in diameter, and if we're lucky, we'll get material from the top couple of tens of kilometers of the surface, and that's pretty much it. So getting a history of the oceans, getting a history of the atmosphere, it all comes down to how much crust material is available. And if you remember anything about plate tectonics, you'll know that continents are not just hanging out and sitting out passively on the surface. They're constantly colliding with one another, they're moving apart from one another, and there's a constant process of crustal material being produced and destroyed at the same time. So what that means is that the rock material that we see, while it seems very stable, unchanging, immutable, when we go back billions of years in the past, all bets are off in terms of whether that material is going to stick around or whether it's going to maintain its chemical composition throughout this entire process of physical and chemical alteration. In the geologic record, another important point is that, yes, it's a rock. Yes, it's mostly inert, but this geologic record is mostly inseparable from the history of life. And the history of life has had a profound effect on the composition of the minerals and rocks that we find. Perhaps the biggest example of this is the Great Oxidation Event, right in the middle of Earth's history, as denoted by this yellow shaded bar in the middle. The Great Oxidation Event overturned the entire organization of the biosphere, because organisms prior to that time were mostly adapted to anoxic conditions. There was not a lot of oxygen around. And oxygen, despite the fact that we think about it as being totally necessary for our metabolism, most organisms don't really like it that much. And in fact, a lot of the organic compounds in our own body don't really like oxygen that much either. And we have to constantly mitigate this effect of oxidation to maintain our own body. And we love oxygen. So at the time, a lot of the organisms that were around just had to find some way to adapt to this very destructive compound. And the same can be said for the minerals that were around at the same time too. A lot of minerals formed early on in Earth's history with the increased presence of oxygen became very vulnerable to oxidation and weathering. And so a lot of the rocks that we see around that are mostly stable or persistent today may not have been formed, or may have been, there may have been other minerals that were quickly weathered away after this rise in oxygen. Now I say it's mostly inseparable from the history of life. When we get down into the lower levels of the onion structure of the Earth, the history of the life on Earth is going to have less of an effect. So, and a lot of people have worked with the available data and come up with different suggestions as to how much crustal material actually existed and has been subsequently reworked between the beginning of the formation of the planet and today. So in this plot, what we see are many different models for trying to fit different models of crustal accumulation into the very few pieces of data that are available to us. So on the left, we have the very beginning of the planet, the formation of the planet 4.5 billion years ago. All the way to the right, we have today, and we have 100% crustal volume content. And all of the different colored lines in between are different ways that you can sensibly interpret those scraps of data to say how much continental crust has accumulated and been produced over time. When we look, we're going to step one level below that. So this purple dashed line that goes up increasingly to the right, as we see, is the recording of the present day exposure of continental crust material that we have available today. And when we try to dig into the different mechanisms and the relationships of production and destruction of continental crustal material, we see it's not quite so simple. It's not just this process of gradual accumulation to the present. So that same dotted purple dash line is represented in this picture by this shaded purple material to the left. And we've switched time axes for this publication. So now we're going from left to right, the present day 100% continental crust material, to the very formation of the Earth all the way to the right at 4.5 billion years ago. And what we see is that once we take into account the dramatic effect that constantly producing crustal material and constantly destroying crustal material can have on our numbers, we see that just about anything is possible. It's not a simple process of continental crust gradually accumulates over time. There could have been periods in the deep Earth history where we even had more crustal material than we have today, and it's all about this delicate balance between production and destruction of crustal material. And what that means for origins of life research is that we have to have a lot of caveats in mind when we interpret data that are available from this time. So someone can hold up a rock or a mineral or the atomic composition of those minerals and say, this is evidence for life, or this is a particular environment from the early Earth past. But once you have destruction of material, any event, even these really large catastrophic events like major volcanic eruptions or comets impacting the planets or global glaciations that completely take over the entire planet with kilometers of ice, get reduced to almost nothing in the grand geologic scheme and may not have even been recorded at all, even though they cause major destructive events to the surface of the planet and possibly to life that may have existed. And on the other hand, if we step away from those really dramatic examples and we talk about the more mundane processes of geologic material formation, like gradual sediment accumulation in a lake or at the edges of an ocean, all of those processes of gradual change, even though they may have occurred over millions of years, can easily be wiped out once some of that material is driven from the surface of the Earth and recycled in the mantle. So what it means is that we have very limited rock data from which to draw conclusions about the early Earth environment. And these sampling and preservation biases abound no matter what material you're looking at. And there really is no definitive rock package or rock or mineral that can really give us a comprehensive picture of what the Earth looked like when life first formed on our planet. And what this points to is a really critical need for complementary laboratory data. So we've got some pieces of rock to work with. They provide tiny slivers of a picture of the early Earth environment, but we need to match up physical and chemical reactions as we can understand and replicate them in the lab to kind of fill in that picture between those really narrow slices of picture about the early Earth environment. And so with that, I'll leave you with a couple of references for suggested reading that we've discussed here. And thank you very much.